I think you're a Tommy Pinko faggot, Bob.
7.5 minutes after the hour of 10 o'clock. Welcome back. Third, final hour for this Thursday night, April 23rd, 1987. I'm going to totally shift gears on you. If you haven't caught on, I'm in a very serious mood tonight and really just totally and completely intolerable of frivolity. And the thing I want to talk to you about right now, I'm as deadly serious about as I am over AIDS. And it has nothing to do with AIDS. A week ago, the Federal Communications Commission came out with a shotgun type of directive talking about indecent language on the radio without bothering to say what was indecent. In essence, they said, well, we'll know it when we hear it. Last Friday night, I came on and did about 20, 25 minutes on the directive and received, for all practical purposes, no response whatsoever because nobody really cared. Last Saturday morning, I received a call at home from a friend in Miami, Neil Rogers, who works at WINZ, who had devoted his entire 4 hours Friday to the issue and was devoting 4 hours on Saturday and asked me to join him via the telephone as a guest for an hour, and I did. I heard from Neil again tonight. He called me at home. He has started a campaign, and he has asked me and Jerry Williams at WRKO in Boston to join in. Jerry has agreed, and I agreed. I know in my heart that it's probably going to fail. I'll tell you that right here and right now. I know in my heart that from my end, it is probably going to fail. But the campaign is this. We're going to give out petitions. Petitions to the FCC, requesting that they rescind this inane, ridiculous order. Or directive, as the case may be. And during the course of this hour, I will give you an address and ask you to send in a self-addressed stamped envelope. You will receive by return mail a petition that has room for 25 signatures. I do not have the petition in front of me, so I cannot read it to you, but in essence what it says is, please reconsider your April 1987 directive on so-called indecent language on the radio. Within the next day or two, I will have the petitions in my hand and will read the exact language to you, but that is in essence what it says. I'd like you to consider something. There were 69 complaints received by the Federal Communications Commission concerning Howard Stern. 69. Howard Stern is on in New York and Philadelphia. He has an audience in the millions. And 69 people wrote to the Federal Communications Commission to complain. And the Federal Communications Commission singled out Howard Stern. This is intolerable. This is the work of a handful of fanatics. And the time has more than come to stop these people, to stop them cold, to stop them dead in their tracks. It's perfectly okay to run around believing and talking snakes and ghosts and goblins and ghouls and devils. But it's not okay to run around telling other people how to think, how to talk. And what it boils down to is, this is a situation where it is up to you. These are the people that have told you what tapes you will rent at the videotape store. These are the people who are trying to tell the cable companies what they will show and what they will not show. And these are the people who are now trying to tell the radio what it will talk about and what it will not talk about. 69 complaints on Howard Stern. 69 complaints. It is not very easy to defend what you may consider to be in poor taste. And I've told you before, I don't hesitate to tell you again, I find much, if indeed not most, of what Howard Stern does to be in very poor taste. I find many of the sex help shows to be boring and in poor taste. But once censorship, and that is what we are talking about, censorship is in place, it is very easy to extend it. It is very easy to expand on it. It is a very dangerous, an extremely dangerous tool. Words are not obscene. Censorship is obscene. If you can tell me what you hear on the radio harms someone, if you can tell me what you hear on the radio actually damages someone, then I'll back off. You can tell me that you don't like it. You can tell me you would rather not hear it. But you cannot tell me that it's doing anyone any damage. And what we have here is a very legitimate question concerning the First Amendment. I've said it before, but I will be delighted to repeat it for you. The First Amendment protects speech, unpopular speech. The only exception is when that speech does harm to someone else. Actual harm. And to give you the oft-quoted exception, hollering fire in a crowded theater. You do not have the right to holler fire in a crowded theater because it does harm to other innocent individuals. But hollering a cute little name for the male sex organ does no one harm. People do not get up and run for the door and stampede and kill each other. Giving out advice on the Dr. Ruth show does not cause harm. People do not jump out of windows because it is on the air. It makes some people very, very squeamish. It makes some people very, very uncomfortable. People who apparently cannot get up and walk across the room and turn it off. People who sit home and make a decision that you shouldn't listen to it. Or that someone else shouldn't listen to it. And as I've said, the time has more than come to put these people in their place. If speech harms no one, then it is protected under the First Amendment. That's what the First Amendment is all about. I don't know how often I have people call up the show and say, Bob, I don't know what we can do. Tell us what we can do. Well, this is what you can do. You can put your foot down and say, hell no. I will not have the broadcast industry regulated by a bunch of prim fools. They have come frightfully close to regulating your cable TV. They have already regulated what you can rent or buy in the store. If you are fed up with them, and you tell me that you are, prove it to me. Do something about it. You can invest 44 cents and send me a self-addressed number 10 business size stamped envelope, and I will return to you a petition with a place for 25 signatures on it. We are shooting for July the 4th. July the 4th is our target date to return the petitions to the Federal Communications Commission. We feel as though we have an excellent chance to obtain hundreds of thousands of signatures between Miami, Tampa, and Boston. One of the things I told Neil last Saturday when I appeared on his program, was that there didn't appear to be any real interest in this topic in the Tampa Bay area whatsoever, that people just didn't give a damn. He was stunned. He couldn't believe it. Because the people in his market were going berserk. And the people in the Boston market were going berserk. Not because they're Howard Stern fans, not because they're Dr. Ruth fans, not because they're shock radio fans, but because they are fans of the Constitution of this nation. And one of the reasons, by the way, for all of you media types who listen to this program, and you know who you are, one of the reasons we feel as though we can come up with this number of signatures is because other people have joined in both the Miami and the Boston market. Rock and roll stations, other talk stations, have joined in, put aside silly little competitions, because this is a very important issue, an extremely important issue. And I know that there are an awful lot of people in both the television and the radio industry in this town that listen to this program. It's your neck that's on the line, too. I wish you would consider getting in touch with either me or getting in touch with Neil and joining in this campaign. It has been dubbed SOFAR, S-O-F-A-R, Save Our First Amendment Rights. And if you would send me a self-addressed stamped envelope, number 10, business size, and simply address it to SOFAR, P.O. Box 48579, 48579, St. Petersburg, 33743. Get the petition back, fill it out, and return it. And if we can dump a couple of 100,000 or 300 or 400,000 signatures from all up and down the east coast of this country on the FCC's doorstep on July the 4th, it just might have an effect. I mean, after all, of 69 letters, 69 letters from the city of Philadelphia to the Federal Communications Commission could cause this much ruckus. Just imagine what 300,000 or 400,000 or 500,000 signatures could do. Just imagine. Yeah, I know the airwaves belong to the public. I'm very well aware of that. Much more aware of it than you are. But those airwaves belong to everybody, not just to Mr. and Mrs. Prude. They belong to everyone. And I'm getting just a little bit sick and tired of Mr. and Mrs. Prude telling me what I'm going to watch and now trying to tell me what I'm going to listen to. And I hear from you constantly on this program that you're just a little bit fed up with Mr. and Mrs. Prude, too. Well, no one is being forced to listen to Howard Stern. Nobody's being forced to listen to Dr. Ruth. Nobody's being forced to listen to the Grease Man. Nobody is being forced to listen to Moby. So why should you be forced to listen to Pap? Because that's what these people want you to listen to. Pap. I also know the arguments about the children, too. But any child who is old enough to understand what is being said on the radio is too old to be corrupted. His basic morals have already been set. So that argument holds utterly no water whatsoever. I'll tell you up front, I would not personally listen to Howard Stern. I would find him very offensive. I don't listen to the Q Zoo. I find it very offensive. But I'd go to bat for both of them. How about it, by the way, over there in the newsroom at the Q Zoo? You people ought to be very interested in this. Because today it's little cute words for body parts. Tomorrow it could well be what you guys are doing. And the day after that it could well be what I'm doing. You cannot legislate morality. That is more than just a phrase. It is more, much more than just a phrase. You cannot regulate morality either. And if people enjoy tasteless humor, well, I'm very sorry about it, but it is not radio that has corrupted them. It is not radio that has taught them to enjoy tasteless humor. The truth of the matter is, all you need do is be patient. It will go away. It is a fad. It is a phase. And it is not the first time it has come around. But censorship is much harder to get rid of once it is in place. And we are talking about censorship here. We have had for quite a number of years the so-called seven words, the seven dirty words, and it has functioned very well, thank you, because everybody knew exactly, precisely, what was acceptable and what was not acceptable. But to come out with a directive about indecent language, and then to back it up by saying, we'll know it when we hear it, is unacceptable. So the choice is really yours. You can either fight back, or you can surrender. So far, you have a marvelous record of surrendering. Oh, we can put a woman like Barbara Hattemer on the air for an hour, who would like to regulate cable TV, by the way, in the state of Florida. And we can have these marvelous conversations and get 10 or 15 people to call up and scream, this is an outrage, but nobody does anything beyond that. And the time has come to do something a lot more than call up a talk radio show from time to time and scream, this is an outrage. The time has come to use their tactics, an organized protest. I'm not asking you to pile into buses and to ride up to Washington, D.C. and march on the Capitol, although I wish you would. But I'm not that big a fool, because I think I'm going to have a hard enough time just getting you to send me a self-addressed stamped envelope and getting you to fill out a petition with 25 names on it. That's almost like moving mountains in the Tampa Bay area. But I'm going to ask you to do it because I was asked. And I cannot turn Neil down. I will not turn him down. I don't care if I only get a handful of them. It's better than nothing. If I can get at least 69. Will you do it? Will you get off your damn duff and do it? So far, SOFAR. P.O. Box 48579, 48579, St. Petersburg, 33743. It's 25 minutes after the hour of 10 o'clock. I would appreciate very much hearing your comments on this.